assignment for the department that is responsible for facility management, including the parks and the hospital. The university has about 19,000 students and 5,000 employees, and one department is responsible for maintaining all these facilities. It's not a very big department, and they have their own IT. Now, when we came there, that single department had 29 systems to do the facility management. And some of it is, the colors are different here. Well, doesn't matter. Some of them are like traditional ERP systems, like Oracle HR or Oracle ERP, where they keep track of the money. And others are more specifically like Planon for facility management and the real estatement, so they can plan whenever they want to do maintenance, or they can make reservations for buildings in another system, which is called, which one was that, EMS. So for every single functionality, they would have a different system. And even for the assets, if you look at a building, they would have three systems to keep track of that. One for the structure, it's just the walls and you know, the way it was built. Then one for all the electricity. So if something's wrong with the electricity, they will go into that system. But of course, you also want to know about structure because you have to get in there, right? So you need to know about the walls and stuff. And then a third one was for all the other things that were not electricity and not structural. So just for one building, they already had three systems. Then for finance, they had another one to keep track of their project management. They had a project document management system, plus just a network drive. And so in total, they had 29 different systems to do their day-to-day job. And that was an issue for them, as you can imagine, because it was very hard to get all the information.
One question for, yeah? For the maintaining the building.
Yeah, so one for the one was for the construction itself, so the physical structure of the building. Then they had one for the electricity, and then they had a separate one for other assets like air conditioning, heating, lock, security. Sorry.
Furniture.
Yeah, well, yeah, I don't know. Actually, that's a good point. Probably that one they kept. Maybe they had a separate one for that too. It was crazy. They have very every single system would have their own data, and then they would have a system also for functions, right? So make a reservation for a lecture is another system. Do a calculation of a repair was in the finance system. So every single thing they would do, they would need at least three or four systems. And it's not a very big department, so there's not a lot of people, so it was very difficult for them to get a good overview of what is happening at the university. So basically they had three types of problems with the current situation with those 29 systems. So one was that all these systems were silos, right? So the ERP system only has the financial data. You cannot connect it to project management or to the cost of, you know, the structure of a building. Same for the facility management, as I told you, they have different systems. Then even for Word documents, they would have their document management system, but also network share, and also some case management system. So everything was in different silos, and that was the first problem. It was not connected. Then the other problem was that not everybody had access to all the data. So the finance guy could take a look in Oracle Finance, but he could not look into the facility system. So he had no clue why one building was more expensive than the other, because he did not have that data. He only could add it up and say, okay, well, this is more expensive than this one, but there was no shared information position for all of the stakeholders. And then the last one is that the support of all those systems were very traditional. So if you want to know something and you know that you want to know it, you can go in and look for it, right? So if you want to know when is this air conditioning due for repair or maintenance or replacement, you could go in, look for the air conditioning, and then it will tell you what you want to do. If somebody, like a student or a teacher, wanted to notify somebody something's wrong with this room, there was no support for that at all. So you always had to call somebody from the department. There was no access for other people. But also you could not predict or be proactive about something. In general, when you do maintenance and you do it on a periodic basis, like every year I'm going to replace the air conditioning, you might be replacing units that are not that are not failing yet, so you're wasting money. But also, if it's a very hot summer and you're using a lot of the air conditioning, they might fail before you replace them, right? So just doing it on a time period basis is not really helpful. And their systems did not have any support to be more proactive or to do it predictively. And the other thing is, all the information was only available when you were sitting behind your desk. There was no way of getting information about the assets. Some of it was maybe a little bit visible on your mobile, but in general, all the information they could only get from the desk. So those were the three problems that we investigated. Now, the first thing that we looked at in this case was the building information management, because the, of course, when you're facility management, then your primary data should be accessible and organized well. And so they looked into BIM, which is a building information modeling standard. And basically, what it means is it's a file containing information about physical structures, but also about functional structures. So in traditional system, I don't know if you heard of it, you have like a CAD system where you can make a 2D model of a building, but that will only show you the size and the length, and it will not tell you it's used for lectures or it's used as a church or it's used for childcare. So you don't have any functionality, you just have the structure. And what they have done with the building information modeling standard is they said, okay, I want to combine both the structural and physical characteristics of an asset with the functional, so that if I want to know something about an asset, I can see whatever it's doing, and I can see the size and where it's located. And so basically, there's also another explanation for building information modeling, which is building information management. It's also an M. And that is basically more about trying to keep that life cycle loop closed, because what happens a lot, and it happened also here at the university, is they have a lot of data when they build a new structure, right? So they create a new childcare facility, and so they make a new building. They have all these plans. They're in the network drive. And then when the contractor is gone, that data is there. And then when they start maintaining it and doing maintenance, like cleaning it and doing other stuff, they start new information and they will enter it again in another system. And with BIM, what they try to do is to keep track of the building, the entire life cycle, up until demolition, right? So when you build it, you put it in a system. Then when you maintain it, you use the same system. And then when you're going to demolish it, you still use the same system. So it's about having all the information in one system, functional and physical, but also entire life cycle. So when you start building, you put the data in, and you will keep it up to date until you demolish it. And it sounds obvious to do that, but it's actually not a very common practice in building and facility management, because most of the projects are completely separated from the maintenance. So that's always completely separated. And also, they all have their own representation and functionality, and the physical structures are almost all the time separated. Now, the problem with BIM is there's this general idea, which is, I think, a great idea, but there's still a lot of, if you look at the files, there's still a lot of proprietary formats. So you have to pay attention if you want to do something like that, and take a look at the open BIM file format, so that you can at least exchange that information with other systems. It's called IFC, and it's like an XML-based standard for sharing data. And as I said, the process, of course, is much more easily to standardize, because it's a process, so you're not depending on people's file format. It's fairly, at least it's all over the world. It's a known standard. So there's applications of it in the Netherlands, but also in the US and Asia. So it's used all over the world. As I said, the file structures, there are a number of formats for that. There's not one in the world that's being used. and it's used, as I said, in construction management. If you're doing a big construction project, that is one here across the street, you can use it to put the data in. But also in land administration and cadastres and land registers, you can use it. And of course in facility operations. And basically the process, what it's trying to accomplish is first of all to generate all that data, to get the data in from the start and analyze it and see, you know, how what it looks like, but also to be able to communicate with each other about it and to do some, you know, predictions about what will you be needing if I'm going to do maintenance. Also knowing that if you try to get to an air conditioning and there is an electricity wire there and a very hard wall, that you know what type of stuff you need to bring if you need to repair it, right? So it's very important to get all that information together and communicate about it. Of course, you want to be able to collect the data and produce the data once you're building. You want to make sure that you put the data in. If you want to play with this, there's an open source BIM server on the internet. It's Java-based. It has two versions. One is standalone, so you just download it, you double-click it, it will start your Java process, and then you can set up the BIM server. And then you have to do some settings. There's a tutorial there how you can do it, and that's very important, because I don't think any of us here are engineers that know how to model a building. They have some example files that you can load. Because when we did this project, we had luckily we had a guy that knew BIM and how to model it. Because, of course, I have no clue how to model the building. I mean, I can do this server stuff, but being an actual construction engineer is something different, of course. So it also has some examples that you can load and play with. You can also, of course, get it as an enterprise application, so a WAR file. I installed it on the Oracle Application Cloud Service, but you can also install it on your local Tomcat or Jetty or whatever you want to use. And that is, of course, more useful if you want to connect to it from different locations, because if it's only running on your laptop, you're not going to do much integration, of course. And it's fairly active, so we started out with version 1.4, and now they're on version 1.5, so there's new additions to that open source BIM server all the time. And some of the commercial vendors of that server, they also use similar code base as they use for the open source one. Now, once you have that server, you need to load the models. As I said, there's example files at GitHub. And you have to think about the different levels, because you will have different levels like the electrical, the piping, the construction, and that way you will be able to dive into the right location. Because as you can see here in the different models, the important part is here that you have a picture, a 3D picture, but it's actually 4D as they call it, because you also have information. It's not readable, but if you load them, you will see it. But it has information about those structures. So it's not just the physical characteristics, but you can also put other properties there. Now we have a server, then of course you need to view it with something. In our case, we had a case management system built in Java, and so we wanted a viewer that would fit with that. So at the time we were using version 1.4, and so we were looking for something Java or JavaScript like. Of course, JavaScript is most interesting, because then you can have very, especially when you do it on a tablet or something like that, can have the 3D and take a look, you know, at all angles of the building. So we were specifically looking at JavaScript. And of course, we needed parameters, because, and I will get to that in a bit in our demo, we wanted to open the BIM server and the viewer in a specific location for an air conditioner that failed, right? So we needed to get it some parameters so it would be able to open that viewer on that specific location. And then you want to drill down and see more about what other things are there on that level. Is there electrical wires? Are there pipes or something like that? And so we ended up with this WebGL3 JavaScript viewer. I'm not sure if this is at this moment the best. 2 years ago, that was the best fit for us. And I will show you the movie. It's not pretty. So I'm hoping there's better options right now. But it's very important to find the right viewer to do, of course, what you want to do with the data. So basically, that's HTML, CSS, JavaScript. And what we did, and it's a very ugly solution, we embedded it as an iframe in our Java Server Faces application. And so you can see the building in. I'll show you a little bit of a, where's my mouse, here, a little bit of a demo. But here you could see, here you could pick levels and types, and it would then move to that specific building. Okay, now the IoT part, because that was in the title, right? So that's what you guys came here for. Of course, what you see a lot, and also at this university, is they have lots of sensors everywhere. But all of these sensors are connected to their own, one of those 29 systems, and you're not doing anything with them, right? So if something goes wrong, there might be some alert, and somebody who's sitting behind his desk might get the alert, and then they have to go over and take a look. So apart from having this one file for all of their assets, we also wanted to bring in the information from all the sensors that are in these facilities. And what we did is we picked an air conditioning and heater example, but of course you can imagine that you can have multiple sensors at the university. Even, you know, depending on how many people are in the room, you want to make the air conditioning higher or lower or something like that, you can do all types of fancy stuff. So what is Internet of Things? Of course, I think the hype has died a little bit down. It's more normal use case nowadays. Now the hypes, I think, are with blockchain and machine learning. But IoT is basically the network of the physical objects that can interact with external systems. Because we've had systems and sensors for ages, right? Everybody knows from a hospital you can be connected to a heart monitor, and then you also have a sensor which will measure your heart. And you have a monitor, and it will beep when something goes wrong. But that's not connected to anything else. It cannot interact with the outside world. It's only there, and if you're not near, you won't hear it. You're out of luck. And the other thing is, I cannot switch it on or off, right? I have to go there physically, put it on you. So there's no interaction in traditional sensor systems. They're very closed in healthcare and also in facility management. So I can have sensors, and they're all connected to one specific computer. And if I'm sitting behind that computer, I can see everything. But there's no way to connect those things with other things. Now, when you're talking about Internet of Things, then of course that is what you're doing. You're making sure that you can actually communicate with the sensors and the assets, and also that they can communicate with your Internet of Things or your systems. So that was what we were investigating in this case. Can we make that more useful for the university and use technologies like Internet for that? Now, this was a proof of concept because they had this problem and they wanted to know how to solve it and what the future vision would be. So what we did is we used the Oracle IoT Cloud Service, which is a service that will connect to the different devices that you have. You can then analyze the data, and I will discuss that in a little bit more detail in a bit, and you can integrate it with other systems. Now, the part where you connect to the devices, that's of course also something that the closed system do, right? The heart monitor is also connected to something. The advantage here is that you can add security to it, so you can make sure that only assets that you trust are connected. You can manage them, and so you can also disconnect them again. You can take a look at how many devices you have, and you can have gateways. So rather than connecting every single air conditioning in the university, you can install some gateways in the different buildings and then connect to the cloud service over here. So basically, what you would have here is the university, all the devices, and then here, the Oracle Cloud Service, IoT Cloud Service, but you could, of course, also take another brand, connect all the devices to it, either directly or using a gateway, and then start analyzing. Now, there's a number of things that are, of course, interesting when you do IoT compared to traditional closed systems. One of the things is that you want to combine the different sensors together. As I was saying, and you want to combine the heat sensor with the number of people that are in this room, and then those two together, you might want to do something. You also maybe want to look a little bit ahead or take action if something's missing, if something's not happening. So the analysis that you want to be able to do is fairly sophisticated, and that's something that a number of those closed systems, of course, also don't do. And then the integration. There's two types of integration. One is directly, I want to do something now, which is what our use case is about. But of course, you also want to do historical data research and look for patterns. It's very well possible that every summer, in July, all the air conditioners break down. That's not something you will see if you're looking at them at that moment, but if you take a look at the data over time, then of course you can see something about that. So you can recognize patterns and feed those back into your analysis component. And then of course there's lots of data, lots of services that you could start or that could communicate with the devices. So in our case, we have a complaint system and the BIM system that we want to connect to the devices. So I think when you look at IoT, you can do something extremely sophisticated and make something completely automated. Suppose in the most extreme case, we have a sensor here, and we notice it's becoming a little bit hot. Some system will get notified, and some robot, the one that we saw this morning in the keynote, will come up and fix it. Hopefully not while I'm talking, but you know, you can go very far in terms of how sophisticated you can make your systems, and not in all cases that applies, of course. But even when you just do something manual, it can already help to use IoT. So in this case, what we have done is it's a digital interface, so the air conditioning will notify the IoT cloud service. It will analyze that and send a signal to the complaint system, which will then notify a mechanic who will fix the sensor. As I said before, if the university doesn't just want to solve their problem right now, that not everybody has visibility of all the information, but they actually want to take it one step further, they can save a lot of money by measuring how often is the air conditioning running. And the ones that are running more often, I will go and do maintenance. The ones that are always shut down because their room is never used, I don't have to replace, right? So you can do predictive maintenance and pattern recognition and get a feedback loop in there in the future. But this was not what they were trying to accomplish right now. For now, it was just important to get all the data and all the information together, and so that people could actually use that information. So what was our demo was about? Basically, we would have somebody from the left is the Fred. He's the guy that's servicing the air conditioning, and a professor who's about to give a lecture on neuropsychology at the university. Now, one of the things that might happen, of course, is that your sensor breaks down, so you don't get any data, so you don't know whether the temperature is okay or not. And if the air conditioning is switched on based on the temperature, and the sensor is down, then of course it will be very hot. And so suppose during a warm day in the auditorium, there's no readings anymore. Then what you would like is that Fred will get a signal, and not that you wait until the lecture is there and then the professor is going to complain that it's too hot and then it's too late to do something about it, right? So what you want is that immediately at the facilities department, Fred gets a notification. And he goes and checks the information about the auditorium. Now remember, they have all these different systems. So they have no way of knowing, can I go in now? Can I barge in here and just disturb Lonneke and the entire audience here, or is it empty and can I go in and check the center? So he would like to get some information about what is happening over there right now. So since there's no class, he can go to the center and it's reading again, and so we know now the air conditioning will start as soon as the people are in the room and based on the schedule. So the people in the auditorium never noticed that something went wrong. And that's the whole point, right? You have all these sensors. You don't want to do something when it's already too late. You want to do it before it happens. And that's because of good service in this case, but also because you can save a lot of money by doing that. You can prevent things from happening. And in general, that's cheaper than fixing the problem. So what did we build? We emulated the sensor because it's, of course, for proof of concept, very hard to actually connect to a real air conditioner. So we had a little Java application that was pretending to be an air conditioner. It would send signals to IoT Cloud. Then in IoT Cloud, we would have that air conditioning registered securely and also look for patterns and see that we get regular readings from that sensor. As soon as something would go wrong, it would go into the application that is used for all the employees to get information about facility management, and that will would look up that specific asset in that BIM server and get the 3D picture and all the surroundings of that system. So the solution that is sitting in the middle is a user interface that is accessible to everybody, so the facility managers, but also repairmen that you might need, or customers, so students or teachers in this case. There's integration, of course, to get the signals from the IoT cloud service and other signals, university systems. And it can send out notifications. So it can send out notifications to the guy that's monitoring. And also when something's fixed or something goes wrong. Of course, it's all secured, so you don't show sensitive data to the customers. You only show what they are allowed to see. But everybody's looking at the same data coming from that same system. So in a little bit of a different picture, you can see that all the air conditionings that are connected. Then in the IoT cloud service, there will be a application. And explorations are defined. And here you can start very simple and say, okay, if I don't get any data, you need to do something. Or if it gets too hot, you need to do something. But of course, in the future, you can start doing very more intelligent things with those data and those exploration using pattern recognition and specific types of patterns in your data to make sure that you start the correct action. From there, we connected it to the system that was on-premise, and that system would then notify and read from the BIM server to get the model, and all the data was coming from the legacy applications that were already there, all those 29 systems that I was talking about. So that part we didn't solve, but you somehow have to either move all that data to the BIM server or read from the legacy applications and make sure that all that data is over there. The BIM server, you mean? Oh, that was the user interface. Yeah, that's a Java Server Faces framework that we used. It's a framework by Oracle. It's Java Server Faces based, and we used it to build the user interface. And we put the JavaScript frame inside of that, which I will show you in a bit, is not pretty. So we're looking into some different solutions for that. Also because it would be very important to make it available mobile, right? You can imagine if you're repairing, you want to take your tablet and maybe you're in a cellar, you don't have any internet connection, so you want to have a mobile app and be able to look at that data on your tablet or whatever device you're carrying. So that was just for the proof of concept how we did it. But I think when you actually start building something like that, we would prefer a mobile app, a native mobile app with offline functionality. And then we had the BPM. So that was more the case management to determine what do we need to do. If something's wrong with the air conditioning, we will notify somebody else compared to when something's wrong with a park or something like that, right? So depending on what type of a notification comes in, we use different routing of the process.
Question?
Yeah.
In the campus, you have
Yeah.
How do you manage to reform the input in the cloud?
Yeah.
Each HLT has a.
Yeah.
HLT has each protocol.
Yeah, that's a very good question. In this case it was easy, right? Because we did a proof of concept, so we only have one type of file, which was an air conditioner. What you can do in the Oracle IoT Cloud Service, and what you should look for in other solutions as well, is that you can manage the devices, right? So they, and I started something, I hope it's running, because I had some issues, but you can, when you create a new asset in IoT Cloud, you specify the message and the format of the message that it's sending. And so per asset type, you will specify the protocol, the message format, and the way it's connecting. And then in the explorations, it will understand that because it has the message formats that you have defined for it.
Can you perform parsing?
Yes, so it will, exactly. So, and then it will, in the explorations, you can parse what is coming in and say, I want, for example, if it's sending temperature data in the format with a couple of slashes, it will do, you know, will, you can tell it to leave it out, for example. Yeah, so that's what you also need in a solution like this, because you're right, every single asset, of course, has different protocols that they use. And the way they solved it in the Oracle IoT Cloud Service is that they have a client that they expect you to install on your assets. And so the easiest way, if you have a lot of assets, is to use gateways on premise and to make sure that all those signals and sensors are all sending data to that gateway, and the gateway will then send it to your cloud service. And that way it's more uniform and you don't have to manage all of them in that cloud service, because there can be a lot of data there and a lot of sensors. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a Java EE, so you can run it locally on as a jar file, but then it also internally starts Jetty or something like that, or you can deploy it as a web application, a WAR file, on your application server. And then you can connect to it with whatever client you like. So that's what we did. We took a JavaScript viewer, but you can also connect with it with Java or with Java or JavaScript. That's basically what you can do. But it's a Java EE application. Yeah, and it's open source, so you can fiddle around with it. If you don't like stuff there, then you can change it, of course. And the first version we did, it was horrible because all of the 3D objects and files were kept in memory. And so after, like, I don't know, half an hour, it would totally collapse because it would run out of memory. But in 1.5, they solved that issue, and now you can actually run it. So that's it's evolving, and it's getting better. It's open source, so... I think good to take a look and play around with it.
One question about the web server. Is that especially for maintaining building, or we can use it to, for example, market the different components of this building? Imagine we have a supermarket that we will...
So the idea is that you use it for every element of a physical structure. And so they use it for the structural things, where you have the size of the walls and stuff like that, but also for the wiring and the electricity and all the components. And you can put the information you want next to it. So say you have a supermarket and you want to keep track of the aisles, you can, of course, give them properties to make sure that you can do that.
Electricity consumption. Is that possible to, for example, to in a building have each floor how you need to consume?
Mostly that would be done. So that's actually a very good point. How you wanna connect those things. So from all the sensors from the floors, you would get the information about electricity consumption or something like that, right? So if you have sensors, it will go into the Oracle IoT Cloud Service. Now, somewhere, and that's not here, you need information about the structure and to know that this airco and this airco are on the first floor, and these two are on the second. And that is exactly what you can do here in the Bing server, because here you will have that same ID of that same sensor, and when you click on it, you can see exactly where it's located, but you can even see whether it's, you know, down on the floor or up at the ceiling or something like that. So, because that BIM server will give you all the physical aspects of that sensor, and also all the functionality and properties that you put there yourself. So it would be very good use case for that. But then, of course, you don't necessarily need to have the sensors to do that. Maybe there's some other way you could do it, but yeah. That is the power of that BIM, is that all the data are there, not just my building, but everything, even where it is located, and maybe that something is in front of it, some heater pipe or something like that, right? That's, you can actually see that, because now everything is in one system instead of in three. So this is the application that we built, the ADF one, as I was talking about, this Java Server Faces framework. And basically what we did is we have a starting page for different users, where you can see that you need to do some stuff. And then if something happens, now the part on the IoT cloud I will try to show you later. But you can see that you can either get a manual warning from somebody, or an alert from IoT cloud, and then you could see it was from IoT cloud service. As I said, it's a proof of concept, so we did not do a lot of features there. It has a timeline, so the person that is logging in can see what happened, what was done by the system, and what is done by people themselves. So here you can see some tasks, and one of them is to start the repair. So that's that Fred guy could now start the repair because they got a signal. Then they go into a level, and they show the data. And here our proof of concept failed, because now we wanted to go in right away to the air conditioning, right? And we're still in the outside, and you can zoom in and out. But we couldn't, we were still investigating that to get to the right level in that BIM model for that specific ID. So we didn't manage that. But as you can see, you can do the 3D with this client. So if you're a mechanic and you want to take a look at if you go inside, you can see exactly where that ERCO is located. We couldn't do too much here because of the memory problems we had with the previous server, as I told you. And you can also, you know, point it on the map, because you can put the exact locations, of course, there. So there's a number of things that you can do in terms of integration. So if you look at this problem that they had, so one of them was the information silos, right? So they had all this different information in different systems. And that is really solved by using BIM, because all of the assets are in one server. It's you can look at it in 3D, and it has all the properties and the functional information. So that is really making sure that you don't no longer only have to go into five or six systems to know something. You can put all that information there. It makes it also hard, because if I'm not careful, I put a lot of information there, and then it becomes very difficult to find it again, right? So there's in the Netherlands, for example, there's some consultants that are specialized in how to model BIM models, and how to do the different levels, and to make sure that you put the right information at the right location, because it's quite complicated, not to model per se, but to make it in such a way that it's still usable. And of course, having a user interface like I showed you can make it easier, because you can drill down directly. If we figured that out, we didn't have time for that. So you can help the user, of course, but still, if you are the one maintaining it, you need to have a proper model, and you need to know and have experience with that. So
apart from the visual 3D, you can search for a location, for example?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, so you can look for IDs or stuff like that. So that was what we were doing, but we were not looking in the right level. So basically what happens is, let me see if I can go back to this screen that you cannot see very well. But because there's an API on the BIM server. So let me show you. So as you can see, there's lots of properties. and there's 3D pictures. And so what you can do is you can with the API locate a specific asset, and then you have to pick the right level, and it will go there. So you don't necessarily have to go there by location. You can also go there by ID. So that is where we were with the viewer. We're a little bit playing around, because then that's not the issue, but to get the viewer focus on that same thing, that's where we were struggling. But that's more because we didn't have time, than that it's a limitation of this thing. But there's multiple ways, and the BIM server has multiple APIs to get into those assets. So that was one problem solved by BIM. Then the limited information and the problem of not everybody having the same information is what we solved with that application we just showed you. So we put the case management in there and security, and that way we could give the information that you are allowed to see, but everybody's looking at the same source, right? So everybody would have the information, different stakeholders can see the information that they want to see. So that's what we solved with this. And then, of course, to make more modern processes available, the support for self-service, you don't even have to notify anybody, because before it happens, the system already knows, right? So you have less need for that. And you can start doing predictive maintenance by collecting all the data. You can be proactive to take a look before it goes down. And of course, when you take this mobile and you are on site, you can take a look at the system, see what is there while you're there. So what did they do with this? As I said, there was a proof of concept because they wanted to solve a problem, but they didn't know exactly what they wanted to do first. Now, their biggest problem right now is on project management and having all that data on a network drive and in a document management system and on people's laptops and everywhere. So they would first start with consolidating that in a document management system. Then the next one was to model the buildings. And so they were mostly focused on getting those experts that would help them to model those buildings, and then connect the systems to it, right? So to have all their legacy systems be connected to that so they could use that. And then the next one would be IoT cloud. They felt, as a small department of the entire university, that it would be better to discuss that as a solution for the entire university and not just for facility management, but also to take a look at the asset monitoring. So that was what we did for them, and with the tools that we used were the Oracle IoT Cloud Service and then open source BIM server. Any questions? Yeah, no, so the devices, what we did is we used, let me see if it's running now. I have a simulator. So what we did is we had something's running. We had a simulator. That was playing the air conditioning. So here you can see a heater system. So instead of having a real sensor, we use some software because it's for proof of concept, a lot of work obviously to connect a real sensor. And so this thing sends sensor data temperatures, and you can also make it fail to send a signal. So you can say it's unable to send the signal. So that's what we did for the demo. As I told you, right? So I don't know if you remember, but the sensor will fail. I would just press this button, and then it would send that signal. And then I have here the IoT thing running as well. Let me see. I can show you a little bit about that. This one isn't really responding. Interesting. Let me see, because this is an old version of the IoT cluster. They have a more sophisticated right now. But here, what you can see is you have a, in the current versions, they have a little bit more features, but the idea is the same. Is you can see, you know, how many devices are connected. So here I connected 11. You can see from all the devices the status, also the types. You can see the gateways and the directly connected devices. So as I said, I can every single lamp and sensor I can connect to the IoT cloud service, but I could also install a gateway in a building and just connect the gateway and then connect the devices to this. So that's also something you can see here. You can see here that the trend for the last 7 days, of course there wasn't much happening until I started it this morning, so there's not very interesting interesting data coming out of this. It was a bit more interesting when we were still working on the proof of concept. And then here is where you can do some of your device management. And so there's two ways of doing that. So if you have one single, you can just enter the single one, but that's obviously most of the time a lot of work. So you can also do a batch registration and basically get some Excel or something like that to register it. And if you have, for example, a gateway, you can select that. I'm running it on my VM, so it's a bit slow. So here you can see you also have the security. And of course that's really important in the enterprise. Even at home it's important, of course, but you can imagine that for university you don't want just any device to be connected to it. So you can put here some details and the locations. I'm not gonna register one right now. Then you can define data. So here, one of the things is the alerts that I have defined in advance, and this was one of the alerts, is that from a device, a critical alert was coming in at 4:48, that, well, 3:48 because I'm in a Dutch time, that something was wrong. But you can also do some analytics and explorations and analyze data using the Stream Explorer, and here it becomes more interesting, because then you can take a look and say, okay, if I have a business rule and it becomes higher than a certain amount, I can define all this here with the user interface. I can do location-based services with that, so, well, for an air conditioning it's not such a good example, but suppose you have something that moves, you can also follow that. So there's lots of options in the cloud service to monitor all your sensor data and to figure out what's happening. It's not doing much. Let me see if I can show this one. So I don't know if you remember, but that's what the cloud service is offering, is the device management, including security. Then exploration, so analyzing all the data. Seeing patterns, defining alerts, and then you have integrations. Let me see here, integrations. And so here I have defined an integration. And I put here the URL. So after, you know, if something happens, then send the signal, and that was when I started my demo with user interface, when the system sees, oh, see, there's a new alert, something should be happening. So you can, from IoT, then integrate with any endpoint to make sure that something happens that makes sense in your case. And you can also connect to mobile clouds or integration clouds, so you can connect to different things. As I said, this is a very early version. And another thing that is, of course, important is how long am I going to keep my data? Because you can imagine that you will have loads and loads and loads of data. And if you really want to do analysis, then it makes sense to get this data out of here and put it in some big data thing where you can do, you know, pattern recognition and you know, historic analysis. And in this one, typically what you're doing is just looking at what's happening right now. And so 3 months is probably rather long to keep this. So probably you only want to keep it here a couple of days. And the other information, just move it to some big data store that you have and do analysis on there. notice some patterns and then think, oh, okay, but that means now that I see these, I'm going to create some new analytics or alerts or messages because I have this new patterns that I'm recognizing. So basically that is the sitting in the middle, the IoT stuff, to filter all the data. And so your backend, our system or the BIM server doesn't get hit by all the different, you know, signals that you're getting all the time. You don't want that, right? So you want something in front of it that will keep you, that will analyze it, and only if something interesting happens, then notify the correct system. Okay, that was it. Thank you very much.